morning, everyone. We're going to be receiving the tithes and offerings. And I'm going to read from Leviticus 27:30. It says, a tenth of the produce of the land, whether grain or fruit, is the Lord's and is holy. And I'm going to read also Proverbs 3:9. It says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Giving your tithes is an obedience to God. And by being obedient to God, we build your faith in everything that God will give you. He is your source of everything. Like the song says, the mighty God is everything for us. And, you know, he is the Lord of Lords, and he will give us everything that we need. But you need to believe in what you need and expect in everything that, you know, what you pray for, and give cheerfully with, you know, from your heart and not just grudgingly. So we're going to pray for the blessings to come. Father God, we pray that as we receive the tithes and offering, Lord, that you bless each giver, Lord, and continue to just pour out your blessings, Lord, and open the floodgates of heavens upon them. Lord, we just honor you with everything that we have because it is yours in the first place. And we just thank you, Lord, from our hearts. And we give all the praise, glory, and honor for everything that you have blessed us with and continue to bless us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Before this for Chosen Church, can we have this done for the Chosen Church? Every time before you start, you pray with the children and teach them how to pray. Okay, that is important. So please do that, and let all the rest of the teachers that teach the Chosen Church, you guys pray together and let them do part of the prayer. That's something that God has put in my heart to mention to the Chosen Church already, because he's doing something new already. Okay? Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Okay.
They should grow, so that when they become old, we should not depart from them. You know, we do the training early in their lives, and we will stick with them throughout their whole life. You make a big impact in the young children. That's why it's so important for adults to, you know, be a guideline for their children, because in the end, the children will pick up what you have taught them. And, you know, I put to practice what Pastor Ed said, pray with the children. Every morning I pray with Brianna before we leave for school. And the thing about it is that they listen and they mimic what you do. I mean, you know, you're training them to how to pray and what to pray for. And, you know, she used to pray, and then she said, Lord, help us this, help us that. But I said, you know, you thank the Lord. You don't have to ask him to help you every time. You thank the Lord for this. You thank the Lord for that. And that's the way that we should input in our children every day. For those of you who have young children, even the grandparents, you have an important part as far as to the children that you are around. And let you be that good example. Let you be that light in that child's life. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. You know, I'm going to be ministering from the New Living Bible, and a lot of the New Living is a little bit different from the New King James, but I usually use the New King James, but this time I plan to use the Living Bible. And I just wanted to put across this message. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, that you have given us the insight, Lord, as to your word, Lord. Father, I thank you for every person here this morning, Lord, that you would minister to them, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would open up their hearts, their minds, and their ears, Lord. Father, I thank you, Lord, for their commitment to be here Sundays, Lord, to serve you, to praise you, and to give their all to you, Lord, for you have given us the greatest and precious gift of your Son, Jesus. And we give you all the praise, honor, and glory this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I titled this message is Going Through the Storms of Life. Going through the storms of life. We all go through storms, each and every one of us. Some may call it trials, but in this, I'd like to call it storms. We go through physical storms. We go through financial storms. Relationship storms. Some of you are going through a big storm right now. Some of you, a smaller one. But it doesn't matter what you're going through. It may be, you may be just going into a storm right now. You may be in the middle of a storm. Or you may be in the ending of the storm. But like any natural storm, there is always an end. In the 2000 flood that we had rain after rain after rain. But the storm passed, and the sun came out. The storms of life is no different. Some of us have that storm longer than other people. Some are short storms. But we all go through storms. And some of us need to manage the storms properly. See, how you weather a storm depends on your foundation. What is your foundation? You need to make your foundation strong. In order to weather storms, you need to have a strong foundation. Turn with me to Proverbs 10:25. When the storms of life come, the wicked are whirled away. The wicked have no solid foundation. But the godly have a lasting foundation. What is your foundation? Our foundation is in the revelation of the Word of God. The Word of God is our solid foundation. And we need to stand on that foundation whenever a storm comes. We know who our God is. Our God loves us. He's unchangeable. He's all powerful. He's faithful, very faithful. He knows all things, and He's present everywhere. That's who our God is. And we need to set our foundation on who our God is. I chose this text today because I felt that this was one of the more explainable ones that I could project to you. And it comes from Matthew 14 to 22 to 30. And this is the story about Jesus walking on the water. And I'll just read from the start on 22. And it says, immediately after this, Jesus insisted that the disciples get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake while he sent the people home. After sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone. Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from the land, for a strong wind had risen and they were fighting heavy waves. They were in a storm right there. The disciples on that boat was in a storm. Although about 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came forward to them, walking on the water. Then the disciples saw him walking on the water. They were terrified, and in fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost." The disciples knew the storm was brewing. They could see it all around. Then they see a person walking on water. Walking on water. So in their natural, they would think, what is that? Fear struck them, thinking that it was a ghost. But you see, when Jesus walks on water, he teaches us one thing. Though we're walking through the storm, you see, God is a God of possibilities. He always makes a way. Although the storm was brewing and they had no idea who was walking on the water, they were all afraid. Those disciples were afraid. But you see, with God, all things are possible. With men, it is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. So Jesus walking on the water shows them that the mighty God that they serve can do all things. Everything is possible with God. Continuing on 27. But Jesus spoke to them at once. He said, "Don't be afraid. Take courage, I am here. Don't be afraid. Take courage, I am here." See, no matter what kind of storms you're in, Jesus is always with you. He's always with you. Deuteronomy 31:6. New King James. It says, "Be strong and of good courage. Do not fear or be afraid of them." The New Living says, "Do not panic. Do not panic. For the Lord your God, He is the one who goes with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you." When Jesus said, "Be of good courage, I am here," when you're going through the storms, you can always expect, in fact, you believe that Jesus is with you. You're never alone, whether you're going through a storm or not. He will never leave you nor forsake you. You know, I had I was in HMC for a while. And the nights were long, But I always knew that I had Jesus with me. And how I knew that is because of what the Word says. He died for me. He shed His blood to wipe away all of my sins. And when He did that, I have become the righteousness of God. I can go into the presence of God and be with Him. I can have a relationship. Now I have a relationship with God the Father. He calls me son. I belong to the family of God. That's what Jesus did for each and every one of us believers. And He is in us. And as I lie on the bed, I can have fellowship with God. I can talk to Him and ask Him and just converse with Him. So whenever you're going through a storm, if you're a believer, you will always have Jesus with you all the time. You will never be alone. Going on to verse 28. And Peter called him, Lord, if you really, is that really you? Tell me to come to you walking on the water. Tell me to come to you walking on the water. Peter. Let's look at Peter. Peter was a fisherman. In those days, fishermen was mostly uneducated. No, they were uneducated. They're burly men. Peter was one of Jesus' first disciples. And everything that he did, if you fall back on it, Peter was such an important person to Jesus' life. He was one of his first disciples. He was one that was with him when Jesus was transfigured. He was the one that had the revelation from God that told Jesus, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. He was the one that denied Jesus 3 times. He was the one that Jesus said, be the rock, and I'll be my church, that the gates of hell shall not prevail. That's you and me. That's the man Peter was. And I feel that Peter was a very good friend and had a strong relationship with Jesus. So when all of the disciples, when I look at this scripture and I see all of the disciples on the boat, but only Peter responded to Jesus to get off of the boat and walk to him. You see, Peter trusted Jesus. He trusted him. And he didn't say, Jesus, I'm going to come to you. I'm going to walk on water, come to you. No. He said, Jesus, you tell me to come. You command me. The New King James says, you command me to come. Peter knew the words of Jesus, how strong it was, how powerful it was. He was one of the first disciples. He hung around Jesus for a long time. And he knew exactly what Jesus can do just by his words. So he's telling Jesus, you command me to come and walk on water. And what did Jesus say? Come. Yes, come. Deuteronomy 31:6 says, be strong and of good courage. Do not fear or be afraid of him, for the Lord your God, he is the one who goes with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. Jesus went. Called Peter out. Come, you come to me. See, in the storms of life, are you putting your trust? Who is, are you putting your trust in? Are you putting your trust in Jesus? Or are you depending on what the world system tells you? That's where your strong foundation is supposed to be. That's where you look for your guidance on your strong foundation. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Very familiar verse. It tells us to trust in the Lord. To trust in the Lord with all thy heart. What does all thy heart mean? It's unconditionally. When you go into a storm, you have to trust Jesus unconditionally. No ifs, when, or but. And it goes on to say, and do not lean to your own understanding. Never mind what you had talked about it before. Just believe and trust who Jesus is. And in all thy ways, acknowledge him. Who he is, what he is, what he has done for you. Jesus is all powerful. He's our Savior. Without him, we would not be anything. He's our way maker. He's our promise keeper. He's our miracle maker. That's who he is. You acknowledge him for what he is. And he shall direct your paths. And he shall direct your paths. Who are you putting your trust in? When the storms of life come into your play, who? Are you putting your trust in the strong foundation that you have? Or are you putting your trust in what the world says it should be? See, in Proverbs 20, 24, it tells us, the Lord directs our steps, so why try to understand everything along the way? Don't try to analyze things and figure out things on your own. Most of the time it never works. But if you trust in whom the living God is, then he will get you through. In times of storms, you can always trust in God's promises. We can call on him, and he will hear us, and he will be with us. Psalms 91:2 tells us, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Psalm 91, very familiar. Pastor always drills us about learning Psalms 91. And I have leaned on Psalm 91 in my short stay at HMC. Psalms 91:15, he shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. Who do you trust? Trust in Jesus, or you trust in yourself, or trust in what the world says? Put your trust in Jesus. As we go on, Matthew 14, Dirty. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on water toward Jesus. And when he saw the strong winds and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. That's the way the storms of life come. When we focus on the things like the wind, the storm, like Peter focused on the storm. He took his eyes off of Jesus when he wept, was walking on the water. If he had still focused on whom the living God was, Jesus, he would not have sinned. But he let the fear of the storm, the wind, the waves affect his vision toward Jesus. And in the storms of life that come to us, we need to stay focused on who the living God is, not around your situation or your surroundings. See, Peter let fear enter into him. And a lot of times when we're going through a storm, we let that fear enter in. I'm no exceptions. I really can say this for a fact. Fear is really a spiritual force. It is really a spiritual force. And that spiritual force comes from Satan. Very popular scripture, 2 Timothy 1:7. We all know this. Every time I see the scripture, it reminds me of burning. I don't know why. And it says, 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear. So we know that fear is a spirit. But of power, love, and a sound mind. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Look at the world today. It's driven by fear. It's driven by fear in every sense of the word. I remember Trixie said, when this COVID thing started, she had to turn off the TV because the TV makes things, the news makes things so unreal that people just thrive on that fear. And who is the God of this world? Satan is. And that's one of his greatest tactics, is fear. Fear controls people. And when you're going through a storm and fear enters, Satan is there knocking at your door. You know, HMC, for those of you who do not know what had happened is that I had an issue with blood anyway. And when you see the blood just drain, you the spirit of fear is there. I admit I was afraid. And I can relate with the woman with the issue of blood for 12 years. I mean, your body just cannot function right. You're tired. Focus is not there. But the thing about it is that, for me anyway, I still had a commitment, so, you know, I still went. I took Brianna to school, picked her up. I even cleaned my house, did the laundry. But I was very fearful. Because when it comes to an issue of blood, it affects a lot of things, and I had to finally go to the ER and get a transfusion. You know, transfusion is not like you see in the movies. It's not so, you know. It takes a great deal of work to just have you transfused. You have to check the blood. Even if you have the same blood type as the packet of blood, they don't just transfuse you with that packet of blood. They test the blood that you're going to have, and they test your blood, and then they double check and check with two nurses in, checking the blood, and then they transfuse. And it takes 2 hours to have one packet, 2 hours, no, one packet of blood transfused in you. And during those transfusion, they don't just transfuse you and let you go. Every half an hour they check you. They ask you if you have any reaction. They check your temperature. So it's not as simple as you see in the movies where they just put up the blood and then pour them in and then let them go. No. There is a great deal of process, a great deal of time to have just one packet transfused in you. And I had seven packets of blood. The doctors just shook their head and said, you know, it's a wonder you didn't have a heart attack. I said, praise God. I mean, God, what's your foundation? If you put your trust in God, although fear is coming, you still have the foundation in you. I heard this from Jesse Duplantis, Kathy Duplantis, in fact. She was telling the story about Jesse. And she said, you know, Jesse, Jesus shed his blood for wipe away all of our sins. And with Jesse, because he was so full of sin, Jesus had to have a blood transfusion just to clear out his sins. I thought that was funny. And I do a lot of the Mary Heart, do it good, as medicine. Jesse does that a lot. And during this time of difficulty that I had, you know, I put that on, and you know, it lifted me up, actually. It lifted me up. But anywho, I also experienced fear, and I know that the fear came from Satan. Going on. fear is something that links up with doubt. Doubt and fear goes together. And you know that when I was in there, one section of that that hospital, no matter which level you was, one section they reserved for COVID patients. So the people in there are mixed in with COVID people in the same floor. And I thought that was, well, not amazing, because they were having such a high number of COVID cases. And you know, they emphasize that you do a little walking, because you know, you gotta walk. I mean, man, for the days that I was in there, when I got out, I tell you, it was very difficult to walk, because you were always lying down. Yeah, so then I encourage you to walk, take short walks along the corridor. And I was walking down toward the COVID section. I didn't know it was COVID section. The nurse had to run to me and tell me, don't go there, that's a restricted area, that's got COVID patients in there. And I had to backtrack and come back, and I had to go back to Psalms 91:5. And it says, you should not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrows that fly by day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness. I had to really pray that, because I didn't know, you know, what you hear and what you see, and then, you know, it the fear just comes. But praise God for Psalm 91. See, I shall not be afraid of the terror by night. Who comes in the terror of, in the night? In the still of the night. Let me tell you, the devil, he just plays with your mind in the night. You gotta rebuke that devil. Every negative thought that comes into your mind is from Satan. Never miss. You know, Pastor used to tell me that, you know, if you feel anything, you just rebuke it right then and there. Don't even entertain it. Don't let it even fester in there. You rebuke it right there in the name of Jesus. Rebuke it. But fear is real. It's a spirit. And it's up to you to reject it or to accept it. And don't tolerate with it. Going down to verse 31. And immediately Jesus reached out and grabbed him. You have so little faith, Jesus said. Why did you doubt me? Jesus never told Peter that you have no faith. He said, little faith. You have little faith. He had the faith to go out of the boat, step on the water, and walk on the water until he saw the storm and took his focus off Jesus. And the way, that's what we all go through. When we're going through storms, sometimes our faith is so little that we let the storms overtake us. But we need to build up our faith. See, doubt cancels out your faith. When you have fear and doubt, you have to stand up strong on your faith. Because it says in Hebrews 1:11, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So faith is, in other words, put it plainly, believing something that you have not even seen yet. For those of you who are going through a process of being healed, see that healing in place. Speak that healing in place. Believe that healing is there. For those who are in financial troubles, speak and believe that you are out of debt. Speak and believe that the house is paid. Speak and believe that you will meet all of your financial needs. But a lot of times when we're going through storms, we doubt, oh, I wonder if I will make it. For me itself, I doubted a lot. I was like the wave of the sea moving back and forth. Because the process was taking such a long time. And a lot of times, when your prayer is not answered, and it's taking a while, doubt do come in. Doubt do come in. But you see, the thing about it is that, what's your strong foundation? Do you really believe that God can do all things? Or do you believe that He can do just some things? And many of the times when we pray, we want instantaneous action. We want it now. We live in a now world. We live in an instant world. Instant timing, instant, even instant dinners. Costco got roast beef. They got a whole slew of processed food, GMO products. Trixie. But you know, we're living in an age where we want everything fast. Internet service. But some things takes a process. It takes a while. And it's not that God does not want to answer your prayer, but it's a process where God is molding you, He's maturing you in certain areas of your life. For me, I have a very difficult time as far as healing goes. My finances, I have the faith to believe in my finances. Relationships, I have a strong belief in my relationships. Because in relationships, all you gotta do is smile and walk away. But once you stay there and confront, that's when your relationships get strained. But when it comes to healing, the thing about healing is that you feel the pain. But you see, I'm putting my foundations on God and God's Word. Although I waver, I can always come back, for He will forgive me. Now, I don't know who or what everybody's going through, what kind of storms that you are facing. But keep standing on God's Word. For me, by faith, I'm standing on God's word in Isaiah 53:5. And this is a very scripture that goes with healing. And it says, with His stripes, I am healed. I am healed. Not going to be, but I am healed. So throughout any of the storms that we go through, the storms of life that we go through, remember, God's word is our final authority in our life. Kavita. God's word His final authority in our life. So when we're going through storms, remember, Jesus is always with you. I will never leave you, never, nor forsake you. Trust in Him. Trust in Him. And never fear. Walk by faith. And do not doubt God's word, for He will get you through any storm in your life. So no matter where you are in your storms, whether in the beginning of the storm, middle of the storm, ending of the storm, like I said in the start, you will get through this storm, like any natural storm. It may take a process. But you will overcome. You will be victorious. And I leave you with one last scripture. It comes in James 1:4. It says, "My brethren, count it all joy." When that scripture came to me when I was lying down, I said, "No, Lord, count it all joy. You know what I'm going through." Or, He knows what I'm going through, but you know, it says, "Count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience." Produces patience. "And let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." See, for each and every one of us, what we're going through, whatever storms you're going through, you're being matured in that area. And if you're not going through a storm, or you don't have any storm, then Satan is very pleased with you, because he has nothing to do with you if you don't have any storms in your life. So no matter what, we as born-again believers, our strong foundation is the Word of God. Amen? Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for all that you have done for each and every one of us, that you will make us grow and be stronger in whatever situations we come into, Lord. That let your word have final authority in our lives, Lord. That the word of God is our medicine, Lord. For every situation, that we can depend on you, Lord. For every crisis that we go through. Father, we thank you for your people here, Lord. Those who have listened and received. That we don't walk by what we see. We don't walk by what we feel, and we don't walk by but we walk by what we believe. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. I want you just to truly understand that what we do is that we always give the word of God. And for all the people that come to speak over the pulpit, you know, God is giving me the great discernment to see how good the message is and how much of message is and how much was it with revelation and you know, some revelation, quite a bit revelation. You know, I have the discernment because message can be good all the time. But we need the revelation of God's word at this end time. So I thank the crew for the leadership that come to speak in. It shows me how much they prayed. It gave me great discernment by the Holy Ghost. And that's why God wants the same thing for our chosen church and our youth department that we will be arising shortly. So this is key. Why is it so key? Because of the time and season we live in at. It is the end time ministry to the max. It is to the max. What do you mean to the max? It is God's ministry that is bringing forth such great revelation of Holy Ghost message, not by our own understanding, which we don't amount to much, but it has to be the revelation of God's word. Now, when Peter got the revelation from God in Matthew 16, which was brought forth, that he's going to build his church upon the rock. Now, Matthew is not the rock. Okay, it's the revelation that he's going to build his church on. Okay, Matthew was the small stone that Jesus is going to build his church with. All the people, they believe in revelation knowledge. So you can read the word a lot, but it has to come spirit in you. It has to come life in you. You cannot have a deep rooted revelation in this end time to just have the local word. It has to become spirit. It has to become rhema. It has to become revelation. It has to become a deep and stronger revelation of stronger and stronger and stronger meat. And with all that, it takes, how do we get into this end time ministry to the max? It has to be by the Holy Ghost. It is His ministry, okay? Now, in a way, can somebody go and get the children's church? This is key for this church of the mandate that God has set for us. We need to be awake, we need to be alive, and we need to be focused. I'm glad he brought forth all the faith part that came, you know. So even when we pray, I don't pray for the spirit of fear. God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. I don't pray that. I say, thank you, God, for giving us a spirit of power, love, and soundness of mind. Amen. That's how I pray. You know, why? Because faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And that faith message is that you believe in your heart first, and then you confess with your mouth, and then those things will come to pass. But you have to believe it first, right? Amen. Yeah. Whether it manifested now, or immediately, couple days, weeks, or month, at least you know that you're going to get it at the end result, yeah. No matter what. That's why in Matthew 3, you know, 11? Okay. That's where John talked about him being baptized, you know, he baptized people in the water for repentance of sin.
But however, one mightier than him coming, that his shoe is not, you know, he's not going to even lose the shoes. Why? When it comes to bring you the max, the Holy Ghost ministry with fire. And fire means that you are alive, you are awake, you're not sleeping. You're getting strong in the Lord, amen? I wonder why love was walking out. You know, no force should be in tune to what God is saying. This is done by the Holy Ghost in this church. It's about time that we take a stand. It's about time that we're on fire. It's been what's happening all over the world. This is a time when sins abound. You know, the love, you know, starts to go away. But it's not going to be like that any longer. You see? Why? Because the church is rising up. It is the most powerful entity in this world. Not only in this world, but in the universe. And God has ordained that to be like so. Praise the Lord. People say, oh, you know, everything is in God's hand. No. Not everything is in God's hand. If everything is in God's hand, people wouldn't be starving all over the world. People wouldn't be slaughtered all over the world. It is a church position to be powerful in this end time. I'm telling you that, you know, you need to get full of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Now, how to get them? How to get that fire? Matthew 6:13 talks about that, right? Amen. It is the word of God. Matthew. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. That is the word of God. Praise the Lord. Now how do we get the word of God? Why is it so important that we seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you by the word of God? Luke 4:4 talks about that. Amen. Remember when he was tempted? Jesus? He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. It is the word of God. We need the word of God. Without the word of God, there's no growth. Without the word of God, there's no faith. Without the word of God, we cannot get the revelation of God's word. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Now, so, we need the word of God, but we need more than the word of God. We need to get a hunger and thirst every day, and then we'll be blessed. Matthew 5:6 talks about that. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. That's how God's going to fill us. We got the word of God. It's our daily process. It's the daily food. And we start to put it in us. Then all these blessings shall come upon us. Right? And what happens when you get the word of God? You're going to be walking like Jesus Christ did. You're going to be walking in his fullness. Amen? Let's go to Galatians. Let's look at 22. It says there, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. Keep on going down. Meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. So, without the fruit of the Spirit, without the Word of God in our diet daily, and without us getting hunger and thirst for it every single day, and how are we going to get the desire to read His Word every day? How are we going to get the desire to get the revelation of strong meat and to bring forth the fruit of the Spirit that will keep us from the lust, the lust of the flesh? So, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Why are people walking in the Spirit? By being a doer of God's Word. We got to do God's Word. Amen. Everything that I'm going down the line, because this is what the Holy Ghost just gave me this morning. You see? I prayed all night. He didn't give me the whole thing. He gave me this morning. And this is for you. And it's up to you.
what you want in your life. It's up to you. It's up to you whether you want the max of what God is doing to His church. Amen. So if you live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. That means let us be a doer, okay? And you know what? The crucify the flesh and everything. Let it not be a desire of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. So it's going to keep us from doing those things that Jesus demonstrated He could do. So we know who we are in Christ Jesus. And what brings forth that after that? When you start walking in the fullness of the Spirit, what happens next? Huh? First Corinthians 12. What's that? First Corinthians 12. Says here by 7 verse, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge. There's a special kind of faith beside the word of God. Faith. It's the end time max of that faith. Another is a gift of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these working in one and the self same Spirit, divided to every man severally as he will. Amen. Now, Jesus walked in the fullness of the Spirit. And He walked in the fullness of the gift of the Spirit. Nothing could come on Him, you see. Why? Because when you do that, it's for you to get the fullness of God. And we look at that in Ephesians 3. The fullness of God. Ephesians 3, let's look at 17th verse. It says, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you be rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ with passing knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. That's how we're going to get the fullness of God. Amen? And he goes on, now to him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask for things according to the power that worketh in us. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. This is coming down to the very end of the time and the season where the church has the fullness of who they really are in Christ Jesus. Now, that's why God gave this church has a mandate to shape up the type of preaching and teaching that we do with revelation of strong men. It's giving us the ability to break forth the youth group that's going to come up. It's going to be a very strong youth group beyond what we could even imagine or think. It's not going to be only playing games. Yeah, they're going to have fun, but if they're going to be ministering the word with power, authority, signs following, and everything, you see. And the chosen likewise, the chosen church, same way. Church, this is what God is doing. It's marvelous in His sight. Amen. Yeah. Praise the Lord. So I want you folks to know that every time they come up to preach, I have a soft message from God. Okay? So let's be blessed to the max. You know, remember I told you this is a sheep map. Shema here, huh? And if you don't understand what the Shema here is, it is the ear that
the Israel people celebrate. But our Shitmair began over 2,000 years, about 2,000 years ago. When Jesus came, he suffered, he died, he did all the preaching of truth. He died, and he rose from the dead, and sat down on the right hand of the throne of grace, saving his blood over all of heavenly utensils. When that was done, everything was done, that God himself can use the church. He can use you and I. But it's up to you and I to get hungry and thirst. We cannot be playing game any longer. We cannot, you know, I don't mind. Yeah, we can go and participate in sport. We can go and go fishing, diving. We can do all. And we can play any sport. But the important thing is, when you put God first place, all the things that you are doing now to enhance your own ways, it ain't going to be measured up to what God can give to you and your family. It never measure up to that. And this is an absolute truth which I am speaking about. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Now, when Jesus did all that, we don't go to a sheep meal of 7 years. In the seventh year, they released the debt and everything. And they set them free. And then another 7 years, and they released the debt and set them free. For 7 times. But now, we have the Shitmeir every day that we can participate in. And why don't we go and do that? Praise the Lord. He gave us the word to speak, to create, to change. We need to do that. But the church hasn't really wake up yet. Huh? I know. I just know it. Overall. I'm not talking about this church. I'm talking about the universal church. See? And what I'm speaking to you is what I'm doing all the time. And I'm striving for that. And I'm getting a hunger and thirst for that. Amen? Why? Because we want to live and walk in the spirit with divine help. Who wants divine help? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Who wants no death? Yeah. Praise the Lord. We want no death. And who wants to welcome the of the sinners that will be laid out for the just? I want that. I believe that we are the just. This church is the just. The church is getting to the point where all the wealth of the sinners will be coming into this church, as well as the church getting richer and better to be a blessing for God. And to build his church in Kau, they're going to do a great, great mandate for the Big Island of Hawaii and beyond. Amen. Jesus himself said that he walked in that fullness. Huh? We need to have, we can't be playing games with this praise and worship team. They need to be here all the time unless they have a definite excuse. Amen? I'm telling you the truth. Every ministry of help over here cannot make any excuse except there is a definite excuse between them and God. That's all it is. But if they don't want, that's up to them. They don't receive the mass. So it's all up to you. No matter how young, how old, it's all up to you. And when all this comes forth, then you're going to see what I'm really talking about through the Word of God. That when you speak, you're going to process and bring forth what it is. You're going to speak forth to all of us, all the ones in the natural, but not in the spiritual, because we'll be getting younger and younger until we're 30 years old. I believe that. I speak that every day. Not only for me and my household, for the Ohana of this church too. I speak that all the time. It's about time that we not be afraid of sickness and disease, of germs, bacteria, and virus. Because they will be destroyed before they can even come close if you start going to the right place of knowing who you are. That it will be destroyed before it can come even close to you. But somehow if you fall short of it, you repent quick, and then it will be destroyed then and there. Praise the Lord. I say this to you, church. Because I'm speaking the absolute divine truth of the Holy Ghost. I'm not joking to you guys. It's about time that we start to leave the world and push toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So the word of God says that we have to judge people, but we need to discern the fruits. And we need to discern the character. And that's why I can see how this church is improving. But they still have quite a bit ways to go by giving up those things that are putting God not first place in their life. Not even second place in their life. They think they are, but they're not, because the fruits are showing. Amen. My wife knows about that. You get up. See, because I love her very much, I get on her case to tell the truth. Amen, huh? Right? And she knows that. You know? I had to set her straight. Because if I don't set her straight, then who's going to set her straight? Huh? Who's going to set your spouse straight? You got to tell the truth. The divine truth. We cannot get strife in our family. We need to be strong in unity and in power. Praise the Lord. Full of power and love is for you, for your taking. Amen? It's up to you. It's up to you. I pray that you get a hunger and thirst, just like your pastor does. Because I've been seeing this going on, and it's about time that we start to move ahead. Who's going to move ahead with me? A few, hallelujah. Thank you. Praise. Who's going to move ahead with the church, with me? Praise the Lord. You see, you know the church on fire? They stand up and say, I'm going to be doing that. I'm going ahead because it is for me and my whole household and for the church and for life in itself.
Yes, Lord.
Now who's going to go ahead with me? Still not, praise the Lord. That's why I'm telling you the fruit shows, honestly. That's the Holy Ghost told me to do this to the church. It's about time you guys all wake up, because it is time that no sickness, no disease can touch you. Now, when you speak Psalms 91, you get it in your heart. You don't say, Father, I pray over Psalms 91. No. What is Psalm 91? He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely shall He deliver me from the snare of the fowl and from the noise of pestilence. He shall cover me with His feathers, and under His wings shall I trust. Amen. He shall deliver me from all these things that are going to come. Huh? From the pestilence. From all these things. Thousands shall fall at the side, and thousands at the right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only within thy eyes shall not behold and see the works of the wicked. Because thou hast been the Lord, the refuge, the Most High, the habitation. There shall no evil befall me, neither shall the plague come nigh my dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over me to keep me in all thy way. Praise the Lord. He shall keep me in all thy way. See, He give me His angels to keep me in all the way, so that I don't dash my foot against the stone. You know? And it goes on to say, you know, right? About what Pastor Stanley spoke about. You know? He set His love upon me because of so and so. Length of days and good life. And I even added on to that. Psalm 92, verse 1. Praise the Lord. Why? I'm telling you, church, I'm coming to the point where God has something for me besides staying here in this church. And that's why you need to get ready. You see, I'm telling you, I might come back in a couple months, I don't know. But this church gotta get ready, because if not, praise the Lord. I just want you folks to know that I love you with all my heart. I truly do. That's why I need to be adamant of you getting hunger and thirst after righteousness. You love your family. You love your spouse. You love your friends. You love your children, great-grandchildren. It's about time that you do it God's way instead of living in the best of the max that he has in this last of the last days. Amen. Amen. Father, I thank you right now for these people. And I speak in the name of Jesus that those, the camera is not on, you see, that those in this church will start to be a witness, which have been pushing and pushing and pushing to wherever they go, wherever they are, that they be a witness and they cover themselves with prayer before they go out, and they thank God and cover themselves with prayer before they come home. Not only for them and themselves, but for the church and for the whole community of Kau and on the big island of Hawaii and with the churches of this island. Amen? Amen. If you really want the mass, you want all your family members coming into the kingdom of God. And God will make it happen quicker than what you can even imagine or think. Praise the Lord. Amen. Father, I thank you right now that we all need to be shaking up what's been shaking up in the United States of America. And Father, we know that other sicknesses and diseases are trying to come in to the United States of America. But it will not come to us. For being led by your Spirit, do thy perfect will. Even the disease that they try to put scare right now, even in the United States of America, I don't know, what did they call that, huh? Monkey? You guys heard about that?
Huh? Monkeypox.
Yeah. See, they try to put that in. And they show a picture about that. You know? And then, but that's not any, all that. There's many other things. But that's all right. Why? Because we have power and authority over everything that the enemy is trying to bring toward the earth. Amen? You know, did I mention that about the straight gate? Matthew 7 talks about the straight gate. And then at the straight gate, who broad is the way, and broad is the gate, and wide is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be the entering there. That's not only for unbelievers, but that's for the Christians who got born again, playing around, thinking, I don't see this happen. You see what's happening? But it is happening. It hasn't hit here the hardness of what is hitting in other countries in the world. And it's hitting in America, but not all of America. Father, I thank you that I speak. These people know the power and authority of the love of the fruits of the Spirit, and that start to operate in the gift of the Spirit, Lord, in miracles, signs, and wonders. And Lord, that they are not afraid to speak anything that is of divine truth, because we have the Spirit of power, love, and soundness of mind. That we can do all things through Christ who strengthens in us. Because we are strong in the Lord and power of his might. And Father, we thank you right now, Lord, that we have the fullness of the Godhead bodily backing us up in every area of our lives so that we can lead all victory and no defeat. In Jesus' name, I believe that, and I know this church is going to come up to that. And Father, we give you all praise, thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise and worship God. Team, come up. And then I want to talk to Fred Kane. And Fred Kello. Praise the Lord. Amen.
And she talked to Fred. I said,
what they're going to do. I'm telling her what we're going to do. We want you folks. I'm telling them to get all the group together and set up a meeting immediately with the mayor so that we can discuss and we don't have to go back and forth or find out what's the problem at all. We can solve the problem together immediately so that we can start building the church immediately. And it will be built quicker than what we can even imagine or think. If I don't lay anything by them in a couple of days, I'm going to harm them every single day.
Fred came, and Fred,
Oh, I need to talk to Lama too.
What they're going to do. I'm telling her what we're going to do. We want you folks